Hi, I'm Dr. Padilla. I am a professor in computer science and psychology, and I study how people reason with data visualizations. Now, today, I wanted to give you my professional advice on the five things you need to know when starting out in data visualization. Now, the first thing I want to talk about is often a little misunderstood, and it is that the programming language or software that you use to create a data visualization doesn't actually matter as much as you think it does. It's often the first question that people have when they're thinking about data visualization. You know, which software should I use? There's so many out there. What languages should I learn? The truth is that it doesn't really matter, in that any of the software or the programming languages will allow you to produce the visualization that you want, for the most part, okay? With the caveat that I'll talk about in a second. But truly, given a data set, and if you know the type of visualization technique you would like to use, pretty much any software or language is going to allow you to do that. Now, you might have to override some of the defaults or make modifications yourself, but truly, it is up to you and your imagination what you want to create. And that can even be done with illustrating by hand. Now, what does matter when you're picking a software or a language is one choice, and it's, do you want the visualization to be interactive and online, or static and still potentially online? If you want it to be interactive, then you're in some ways limited to a few different programming languages and softwares they'll talk about in just a second. Now, what do I mean by interactive? I mean that maybe you want your visualization to allow users to click on different elements or zoom into it or have different linking areas of the data itself. If you want to do any of those types of things, it's a bit easier with programming languages like D3.js, Vega Lite, Tableau as well, Plotly. These are all native programming languages that are built to be online, so they are really customized for them. And I'll do a whole video about choosing the different programming languages or softwares you might want to use. But the major distinction to talk about it generally is, do you want it to be online and interactive, or can it be static and also online? And that's really the major choice. Beyond that, it doesn't really matter. It's really about you and your knowledge. Once you decide what you want to do, you can truly get anything all the way down from PowerPoint and Excel to Illustrator to produce the type of visualization you want. So I would worry a little less about sorting out the type of program and focus more on your own learning about how data visualizations work and how to produce the best possible visualization for your data set and your user goals. Now, the second thing that I think you should know when starting out in data visualization is to be a little bit nervous around color. And I say this because I've worked with hundreds, if not thousands, of students and designers. And when they're beginning, they often gravitate to color for all of their data visualization needs. And it's truly fraught with peril in some ways. So I thought I'd give you a little example. So here are two examples, one with a pie chart and one with a scatter plot. And the main issue is that they are just using too much color. Honestly, we have many, many different color categories. And what happens is a user will go through and try to identify the individual category or label from the specific color. And if you have too many colors, that is just really, really hard to do. When you have a great number of different colors within a visualization, that's a situation where you should be nervous. I see students and other people make visualizations like this all of the time, even though they've been warned about going overboard with color. Let's look at another example. So the bar plot on the left here is what you would have with no color. We're simply encoding value across various different categories here. Now you might think, it looks boring, I want to add some color to it. That is the first thing that people do. So you would come up with the version on the right here. Now, if we look at the version on the right, it is prettier, definitely prettier, but it has its own problems that are associated with the color. What is going on is that we visually start to cluster categories of color that have the same type of name. So in our mind, we start to see the greens as being more similar, or the pinks as being similar, or the yellows and oranges as being similar. And right now, the organization of the categories on the bottom is totally arbitrary. So to visually cluster that information is incorrect. It's actually adding information that is not in the data set per se. So just the application of color here, done in an arbitrary way, can lead to incorrect conclusions about the chart itself. Let's look at a more specific example. So this is a very similar data set where we have breeds of animals, cats and dogs, and their cuteness on the y-axis. This is entirely fictional data, okay? I just made this up for this example. We have the same color encoding as previously done, and we kind of have the similar issues where you start to cluster the greens together and the pinks together and the oranges together, and that has no meaning at all. It's adding meaning that is fully arbitrary based on the encoding itself. Now, a better way to use color, if you did want to use color here, which you don't have to, is to think about, how could I encode meaning with color? How could I add additional information with that color that would otherwise not be there? So here's an alternative technique where I simply color coded the cat breeds and the dog breeds. The cat breeds are in orange and the dog breeds are in purple. So already we're starting to see some insights that we can gain. First of all, there's fewer cat breeds than dog breeds, okay? You can start to maybe kind of compare the cuteness scale across the two. Maybe that's interesting to you. But also notice that we have the darkest color of orange and purple all the way on the left, and it goes to lighter to the right. That is an ordered color scale, and that is implying a certain order just based on the color itself, which is still arbitrary. I'm not saying here that a Prussian cat is somehow darker orange than a Sphinx, because we don't know what darker orange means, okay? But maybe we do want to encode that with something. Maybe we want to give that meaning. So another thing you could do is then sort the information. So now what we're seeing here is that the darkest orange and the darkest purple is related to the most cuteness. So if you wanted to go through and find the cutest cat and the cutest dog, you look for both the tallest and the darkest bar, and it is double encoding that information and making it easy and effective to extract. So this is an example of how I might want to spruce up a visualization by adding color and not do it in an arbitrary way, but do it in a way that adds value to the visualization. Here's another example that doesn't have a continuous encoding, just two colors, just for cats and just for dogs. And this allows you to compare the overall proportion of cute animals that are cute breeds that are dogs versus cats. And this is, again, arbitrary data. I just made it up. But you might come to a conclusion that dogs are cuter than cats in this type of organization, which is not true. But it is a comparison that you could make. Those are a few examples of how to use color in an informative way. But I still just want to advocate for, when you're starting out in data visualization, you should be wary about arbitrarily adding color in this way to make it look nicer. It will make it look nicer, but it can add more problems unless you're doing it in an informed and careful way. My third thing that you need to think about when starting out in data visualization is the type of tasks that your users are doing. If I go back to my example with this dog and cat breed, there are two different tasks that this encoding here that has the kind of sorted cats and dog breeds separately could afford or allow than this visualization here. Well, what we can do nicely in this version is we can look at the highest and lowest cuteness rated cats, and those are sorted for us. So we know within cats, we know the ordering of cuteness, and within dogs, we know the ordering of cuteness. So if you know that your user wants to have a sorted list and be able to easily find the highest and lowest cuteness cat and dog separately, but then still relatively compare the two, this might be an encoding technique that you use. So if you know that your user will want to look at the entire set and understand the most cute animal across the set and in descending order, this might be a visualization that you choose. So that's to say that you should define the best practices based on the types of tasks you think your user is going to do. And to do that, take some more knowledge that we'll talk about throughout this video series. But suffice to say, you should always, always consider the tasks that your users might be doing. The fourth thing that I think you should consider when starting out in data visualization is that the most exciting visualization is not always the best visualization. So oftentimes, new designers want to make something kind of bold and flashy and really, really interesting. And that can be fun for you to express yourself creatively. But that's not necessarily the best visualization for a particular task. For example, there was several studies on this topic, but one that I find really fascinating took a look at different images of brain regions in a scientific publication. And here is an image of these different types of visualizations of brains. And they change the visualization of the brain to be more three-dimensional, at the top all the way down to very schematic, flat, two-dimensional visualization. And what they discovered that is as the brain image became more three-dimensional and more scientific and kind of fancier looking, people believed that the text statements around the visualization were more scientific. Even if the information was presented exactly in the same way, people thought that the text that was describing the results was more scientific when the visualization was more three-dimensional and flashy. Okay. So the basic finding is that people think that these more fancy high-tech visualizations are more reputable, more desirable, etc. Now there's other work that finds that even though people think that is the case, those can often be the worst performing in tasks, that they can be the hardest to use in some ways because it's kind of hard to extract specific information from these visuals. So when you're thinking about the visuals that you want to create, you might be enticed to make these beautiful, fancy, scientifically advanced visualizations, but those are not necessarily the best for the task. Sometimes a simple, clean, straightforward visualization can be the most effective. And the fifth thing I think you should know when starting out in data visualization is to be creative. What I often see is that people fixate on a certain visualization type when they get started. And that's often the ones they happen to know. So we're talking pie charts, bar charts, line charts, scatter plots. But there is a whole world of different visualizations out there that I think you should try. For example, here is a really, really cool website from this really interesting design group here. And what they've done is they've taken this data set here, which shows World Heritage sites in Norway, Denmark, and Sweden in two different years. And they visualize this one data set 100 different ways. So some of the first ones you can imagine is maybe something you thought about when you looked at that data set, a simple, stacked bar chart. These are basically bars, 3D bar. But as you go through, you realize there are 100 different ways to visualize the same data set, which is truly, truly miraculous. So I think early on when people start in data visualization, they get fixated on the first type of visualization they think of. And I would encourage you to prototype, make lots of drawings in terms of small examples that you might decide to actually flesh out to really expand the different chart types that you might consider using. And those were the five things I think you should think about when starting out in data visualization. I wanted to end on a few book recommendations if this is interesting to you. The first one I'll start with is this book by Tamara Munsner, Visualization, Analysis, and Design. This is the standard textbook that we use in most visualization classes. So if you want to kind of get the academic flavor of data visualization, take a look at this one. It's comprehensive and fantastic. The next one I will recommend is this book by Jen Christensen, Building Science Graphics. If you are more interested on the design side and building more scientific infographics, I think this is a good alternative to the more academic book by Tamara Munsner that I just pointed out. And this is truly beautiful. Jen is a fantastic designer, so definitely take a look at that. Now, if you're just interested in this topic generally and you're looking for a little bit more of kind of a pop culture type book, this is a book called How I Learned to Understand the World by Hans Rosling. He's one of the founders of interactive data analysis, and this is a really amazing book that talks about his life and how he came to visualization in a really amazing way. And he passed away several years ago, so this is a very beloved book. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you have any questions or comments, or even if you have a specific data visualization topic that you would like me to cover in future videos, please comment down below and subscribe. I'm very interested to help you become the best visualization designer you can be. Take care.